Hello. I'm going to read chapter 9 and 10. Make your bed. These are the last two chapters. And I think the next is the commencement speech of these soldiers graduating. So, let's get to it. Thank you for your time. Thanks for spending moments with Myra. I hope I'm relaxing, y'all. And I hope this is okay. Let's get to it. This is chapter 9. Give people hope. If you want to change the world, start singing when you're up to your neck in mud. The night wind coming off the ocean was gusting to 20 miles an hour. There was no moon out, and an evening layer of low clouds obscured the stars. I was sitting in the chest deep mud, covered from head to toe with a layer of grime. My vision blurred by the cake on the cloud. I could see only the outline of my fellow students lined up in the pit beside me. It was Wednesday of Hell Week, and my SEAL training class was down at the infamous Tijuana Mud Flat. Hell Week was the seminal event for the first phase of SEAL training. It was 6 days of no sleep and unrelenting harassment by the instructors. There was long runs, open sea swims, obstacle courses, rope climbs, endless sessions, and constant paddling of the inflatable boat small. IBS. The purpose of Hell Week was to eliminate the weak, those not tough enough to be SEALs. Statistically speaking, more students quit during Hell Week than at any other time in the training. And the mud flats were the toughest part of the week. Located between South San Diego and Mexico, the mud flats were a low-lying area where draining from the San Diego created a large swath of deep, thick mud and had the consistency of wet clay. Earlier that afternoon, our class had paddled out a rubber boat from Coronado down to the mud flat. Soon after arriving, we were ordered into the mud and began a series of races, an individual competition designed to keep us cold, wet, and miserable. The mud clung to every part of your body. It was so dense that moving through it exhausted you and tested your will to carry on. For hours, the race continued. By the evening, we could barely move from the bone-chilling coldness and the fatigue. As the sun went down, the temperature dropped, the wind picked up, and everything seemed to be getting even harder. Morale was declining rapidly. It was only Wednesday, and we all knew that the other 3 days of pain and exhaustion lay ahead. This was the moment of truth for a lot of the students. Shaking uncontrollably, with hands and feet swollen from the non-stop use and skin so tender that the slightest movement brought discomfort. Our hope for completing the training was fading fast. Silhouette against the distant light of the city, a SEAL instructor walked purposefully to the edge of the mud flats. Sounding like an old friend, he softly talked into a bullhorn and offered comfort to the suffering trainees. We could join him and the other instructors by the fire, he said. He had hot coffee and chicken soup. We could relax until the sun came up. Get off your feet. Take it easy. I could sense that some of the students were ready to accept his offer. After all, how much longer could we survive in the mud? A warm fire, hot coffee, and chicken soup sure sounded good. But then came the catch. All he needed was for five of us to quit. Just five quitters, and the rest of the class could have some relief from the pain. The student beside me started to move towards the instructor. I grabbed his arm and held him tight. But the urge to leave the mud was too great. He broke free of my grasp and began to lunge for the dry ground. I could see the instructor smiling. He knew that one man quit, others would follow. Suddenly, above the howl of the wind, came a voice, singing. It was tired and raspy, but loud enough to be heard by all. The lyrics were not meant for tender ears, but everyone knew the tune. One voice became two, and two became three, and then, before long, everyone was singing. The students rushing for the dry ground turned around and came back beside me. Looping his arm around mine, he began to sing as well. The instructor grabbed the bullhorn and shouted for the class to quit singing. No one did. He yelled at the class leader to get control of the trainees. The singing continued. With each threat from the instructor, the voice got louder, the class got stronger, and the will to continue on in the face of adversity became unbreakable. In the darkness, with the fire reflecting on the face of the instructor, I could see him smile. Once again, we had learned an important lesson: the power of one person to unite the group, the power of one person to inspire those around, to give them hope. If that one person could sing while neck deep in the mud, then so could we. If that one person could endure the freezing cold, then so could we. If that one person could hold on, then so could we. The large room over Dover Air Force Base was filled with grieving families, inconsolable children sobbing in their mother's arms, parents holding hands, hoping to gain strength from each other, and wives with a far-off look of disbelief. Just 5 days earlier, a helicopter carrier, Naval SEAL, and the Afghan Special Operating Partners, and flown by Army aviators, had been shot down in Afghanistan. All 38 men on board were killed. It was the single greatest loss in the War of Terror. In less than an hour, a large C-17 transport aircraft was scheduled to land over Dover. And the families of the fallen heroes would be escorted to the flight line to meet the flag-draped coffin. But as the families waited, the President of the United States, the Secretary of Defense, the Service Secretary, and the senior military leader filed into the waiting room to pay their respects and give comfort where they could. I had attended dozens of service for fallen soldiers. It was never easy. And I often wondered whether my words of solace made any difference to those who lost loved ones, or whether the shock of their loss made everything I said incomprehensible. As my wife, Georgianne, and I began to talk with the families, I struggled with the right words. How could I truly empathize with their pain? How could I tell them that the sacrifice of their sons, their husbands, their fathers, their brothers, their friends was worth it? I did my best to console each one. I hugged them. I prayed with them. I tried to remain strong for them. But somehow, I knew my words fell short. Then I knew, down beside the elderly woman, I noticed the family next to me talking with the Marine Lieutenant General John Kelly, the military assistant to the Secretary of Defense. Kelly was tall, lean, with close-cropped gray hair, and dressed in an immaculate Marine uniform. The family was gathered around him, and I could see, and I could sense that his words of sympathy and encouragement in their face of this tragedy were having a profound effect on the grief-stricken parents and children. He smiled, they smiled. He hugged, they hugged back. He reached out his hand, and they grasped it tightly. After embracing the parents one last time and thanking the family for their sacrifices, Kelly moved on to the next group of heartbroken survivors. During the next hour, John Kelly touched almost every family in the room. More than any other visitors that day, Kelly's words resonated with every parent, every wife, every brother, and every sister, and every friend. His words of understanding, his words of compassion, and above all, his words of hope. Only John Kelly could have made a difference that day. Only John Kelly could have given them hope, because only John Kelly knew what it was like to lose a son in combat. Marine First Lieutenant Robert Kelly was killed in Afghanistan in 2010 while serving with the 3rd Battalion, 5th Marines. General Kelly and his family had struggled with the tragedy, just like the families at Dover that day. But the Kelly family survived. They had endured through the pain and the heartache and the inconsolable sense of loss. As I watched him that day, he also gave me strength. The truth is, when you lose a soldier, you grieve for the families, but you also fear that the same fate may someday befall you. You wonder whether you could survive the loss of a child, or you wonder how your family would get along without you by their side. You hope and pray that God will be merciful and not have you shoulder this unthinkable burden. Over the course of the next 3 years, John Kelly and I became close friends. He was a remarkable officer, a strong husband to his wife, Karen, and a loving father to his daughter, Kate, and the oldest son, Marine Major John Kelly. But more than that, without even knowing it, John Kelly had all those around him hope. He gave all of them around him hope. Hope that in the very worst of times, we could rise above the pain, the disappointment, and the agony, and be strong. That we could each have within us the ability to carry on, and not only to survive, but also to inspire others. Hope is one most powerful force in the universe. With hope, you can inspire nations to greatness. With hope, you can raise up the downtrodden. With hope, you can ease the pain of unbearable loss. Sometimes all it takes is one person to make a difference. We will all find ourselves neck deep in mud someday. This is the time to sing loudly, to smile broadly, to lift up those around you and give them hope that tomorrow will be a better day. Tomorrow will be a better day. Chapter 10. Never, ever quit. Never, ever quit. If you want to change the world, don't ever, ever ring the bell. I stood at attention along with the other 150 students beginning the first day of SEAL training. The instructor, dressed in combat boots, khaki shorts, and a blue and gold t-shirt, walked across the large asphalt courtyard to a brass bell hanging in the full view of all the trainees. "Gentlemen," he began, "today is the first day of SEAL training. For the next 6 months, you will undergo the toughest course of instructions in the United States military." I glanced around and could see some of the apprehensions on the faces of my fellow students. The instructor continued, "You will be tested like no time in your life." Pausing, he looked around the class of new tadpoles. "Most of you will not make it through. I will see to that." He smiled. "I will do everything in my power to make you quit." He emphasized the last three words, "make you quit." "I will harass you mercifully. I will embarrass you in front of your teammates. I will push you beyond your limits." Then a slight grin crossed his face. "And there will be pain, lots and lots of pain." Grabbing the bell, he pulled the rope hard, and a loud clanging noise echoed across the courtyard. "But if you don't like the pain, if you don't like all the harassment, then there is an easy way out." He pulled the rope again, and another wave of deep, metallic sound reverberated off the building. All you have to do is quit. All you have to do is ring this bell 3 times to quit. He let go of the rope tied to the bell clapper. Ring the bell, and you won't have to get up early. Ring the bell, and you won't have to do long runs, the cold swims, or the obstacle courses. Ring the bell, and you can avoid all the pain. The instructor glanced down at the asphalt and seemed to break from his prepared monologue. But let me tell you something, he said. If you quit, you will regret it for the rest of your life. Quitting never makes anything easier. 6 months later, there were only 33 of us standing at the graduation. Some had taken the easy way out. They had quit. And my guess is the instructor was right. They will regret it for the rest of their lives. All of the lessons I learned in SEAL training, this was the most important. Never quit. It doesn't sound particularly profound, but life constantly puts you in situations where quitting seems so much easier than continuing on, where the odds are so stacked against you that giving up seems the rational thing to do. Throughout my career, I was constantly inspired by men and women who refused to quit, who refused to feel sorry for themselves, but not more than a young Army Ranger I met in a hospital in Afghanistan. It was late one evening when I received word that one of my soldiers had stepped on a pressure plate. A pressure plate mine, and had been medevacuated, to the compound hospital near my headquarters. The ranger, regimented commander, Colonel Eric, and I quickly made our way to the hospital into the soldier's room. The soldier lay in the hospital bed, tubes extending from his mouth and chest, blast burns streaked up his arms and across his face. The blanket covered his body, lay flat to the bed where his legs would normally have been. His life was changed now forever. I had made countless visits to the combat hospital in Afghanistan. As a wartime leader, you try not to internalize the human suffering. You know that it is part of combat. Soldiers get wounded. Soldiers die. If you allow every decision you make to be predicated on the possible loss of life, you will struggle mightily to be effective. Somehow, thoughts this night seemed different. The ranger lying in front of me was so very young, younger than my two boys. He was 19 years old, and his name was Adam Bates. He had arrived in Afghanistan just a week earlier than this had been. This had been his first combat mission. I leaned over and touched his hand to his shoulder. He appeared to be sedated and unconscious. I reflected for a minute, said a little prayer, and was starting to leave when the nurse came in to check on my soldier. She smiled, looked at his vitals, and asked me if I had any questions regarding his status. She informed me that both of his legs had been amputated and that he had serious blast injuries, but that his chance for survival was good. I thanked her for taking such good care of the ranger and told her I would return when he was conscious. "Oh, he's conscious," she stated. "In fact, it would be good for you to talk with him." She gently shook the young ranger, who opened his eyes slightly and acknowledged my presence. He can't speak right now," the nurse said, "but his mother was deaf and he know how to sign." The nurse handed me a sheet of paper with various sign language symbols displayed on it. I talked for a minute, trying to find the strength to say the right thing. "What do you tell a young man who has lost both his legs serving his country? How do you make him feel better about his future?" Bates, his face swollen from the blast, his eyes barely visible through the redness and the bandages, stared at me momentarily. He must have sensed pity in my expression. Raising his hand, he began to sign. I looked at each symbol on a sheet of paper before me. Slowly, painfully, he signed, "I will be okay." And then he fell back asleep. As I left the hospital that evening, I could not help but to cry. Of the hundreds of men I've talked to within the hospital, never once did anyone complain. Never once. They were proud to serve their country. They were accepting their fate. And all they wanted to do was get back to their unit, to be with the men that they had left behind. Somehow, Adam Bate personified all those men who had come before him. A year after my hospital visit in Afghanistan, I was at the 75th Ranger Regiment change of command. There in the stand was Ranger Bate, looking sharp in his dress uniform and standing tall on his new leg, his prosthetic leg. I overheard him challenge a number of fellow Rangers to pull-up contests. With all he had been through, the multiple surgeries, the painful rehab, and adjusting to new life, he never quit. He was laughing, joking, smiling, and just as he promised me, he would be okay. Life is full of difficult times, but somehow there always has someone out there always having worse than you. If you fill your days with pity, sorrow, for the way you have been treated, bemoaning your life circumstances or someone or something else, then life will be long and hard. If, on the other hand, you refuse to give up your dreams, stand tall and strong against the odds, then life will be what you make of it. And you can make it great. Never, ever ring the bell. Remember, each day with the task completed, find someone to help you through life. Respect everyone. Know that life is not fair and that you will fail often. But if you take some risks, step up when times are tough, face down the bullies, lift up the drowned rotten, and never, ever give up. If you do these things, then you can change your life for the better, and maybe the world. And maybe the world.